It's a tutorial on how to do a parallel coordinates graph in R. Wednesday, October 22nd, 2014. It's based on the spelling differences chapter and visualize. So let's see, if in iLearn, you should be able to find a graph, just do a find. There it is. Okay, and I've added these little pictures so that you have a quick reference there. So there's a PDF and all the links should be open, should be outside of iLearn, so you should be able to get all the information. Before I go over it though, let's open up the chapter in the book that talks about it, which is chapter 7. Let's just quickly go. It starts out with this exercise on how to do, it's kind of like a heat map where each spot is like a different color. If it was on a map, it would be kind of, the shapes would be sort of different. But here it's just like a matrix. And what it does, but the same type of operation that it does in order to do the parallel coordinates, it does here. And that is, rather than having columns that are reads, and then uses somehow and puts them in relation to each other, what you have to do here is you actually have to make the graph so that it literally displays the information within each cell as if it were a map itself. So the spreadsheet becomes almost like a map, and each cell becomes, let's say, a particular color. And in order to do that, there is a step which is called putting it into a matrix. So we'll see how that works out, but basically you have to take the data in your column, let's say if you have two columns from point A and point B, and then you have to create a kind of a string is the wrong word, but you have to put this in sequence. So you have to take this piece of information, that piece of information, this one, this number, and just put them in a single row, and they have to be, of course, even numbers, and then the rest of the code tells it how to read it. But it's a little bit counterintuitive to just grab all that information, put it in a sequence. So it's called a matrix format rather than a data frame. Not exactly sure what that means, but basically it just puts it precisely in each spot as if you were like painting into the cells. And I don't know, I find these heat maps somewhat, again, kind of underwhelming because, yeah, you can spot like some hot spots. This is for basketball stats for a bunch of players. It does remind me a little bit of the spaghetti stuff that I don't like, which is you have a lot of, and the trouble with it, it's also very hard to sort. I don't know, this page is upside down, but anyway. So anyway, within the same chapter, using the same type of operation with the data, some other stuff that I don't think is very useful, including spider charts, which sometimes can be useful, but I'm curious how to do those. Okay, here we go. All right. Okay, well, actually, there's an inventor in 1885. So you have categories, and they do something at point B, the categories at A, they do something at point B, something at point C, and something at point D, and you can play with this, with the order of B, C, and D, right? And that's what the exercise does in the book, showing something about education. Something like, you know, student to pupil ratio, percentage of graduation, percentage of the SAT, writing, math, different scores. And so I think the problem with something like this, of course, he puts it, you know, horizontally. The trouble is that you might see some relationships, but really the categories are just too many for one. And that's why even when you have a power coordinate that has 3 points, it's usually too much. It's best to just go from A to B, period. So I got lost here. I got it to work, but it just seemed, you know, so overwhelming, or earlier I said underwhelming, not very satisfying, and yet, you know, too much overload. So, and he talks about how to highlight some of the lines and how to, you know, keep some gray and make some black, and you know, that kind of stuff. For our purposes, it's easier done in, I think, Illustrator. So this is the education in the United States. And the code is actually quite simple. We're going to use a library that is called Lattice, which is the one used in the book. So let's open the tutorial. And so you can get the code, which that doesn't work, but at the end of the page, yeah, here it is. Okay. Let's just see what I looked at. So what I did was I tried to replicate I tried to replicate this graph by this works for whatever reason. The other, yeah. So this guy analyzed like how much money people were spending, teams, and how well they were doing, and he did it like for the entire season. It's just a, you know, it's code, right? So as soon as he got the information. So this is for 2005. So the blue lines are the good stuff, where the best team. This happens actually to be the Giants last year in the middle of the season. No, this year rather. They're doing quite well, but they're still paid a lot of money to their players, right? So you can actually use these for things that are not just like, you know, date number one and date number two. So in this case, it's comparing again the performance, how many wins versus how much they're spending. And you can see the Dodgers and the Yankees are not doing so well because their record is not as good. And the nice feature about this is interactive. What's not so nice about processing, you can see, is that as you zoom in, it starts breaking up because it's pixel based. So even the type is all pixel based, and also you need. So anyway, I just replicated this for a particular date. I can't remember now. I replicated the record from 1 year to the next. So I went and got the information at some baseball website. And oh, why it's not moving. Okay. So I wanted to compare I guess the top 15 teams maybe and their percentage in 2011 versus their percentage in 2012. And the percentage again is done by, let's see, dividing the total number of games by the number of wins, something like that. And I guess if you're at 500, you've only won half of the games. So the first thing we need to do is copy this information and rearrange it. So let's see. I did some cleaning up. Yeah, so here's what needs to happen. I mean, you can just copy the code in the tutorial, but what needs to happen is that we take now these numbers, right? We have the category, which is the team. We have point A, which is 2011. Point B, it's 2012. And we go down for the different teams. What we need is we need to have, this is a separate list, and these two sets of number as another separate list, but it's like all connected together. So what we need to do is take the first two numbers, then take the second two numbers and just put them in a row, okay, separated by commas. So I just did by using, I just did cut and paste, okay, nothing fancy there. So if you remember these 630, 500, 599, those are the first three. When we look at it in the code, that's what they are, right? Right here, 630, 500, 599. So you can see how you could lose track of them, so but make sure that you get them all. So here you have X amount of numbers. Here you're going to have half of that X in terms of number of teams, right? Because each team is going to take two of these numbers in the graph. And we need to install this library called Plottrix. Okay, so now I'm going to try to copy the code from the PDF, which could be iffy, right? Because I could have crap in my text in the PDF, but if not, take it from the this file, which is in the parallel coordinates link. I think I'm going to go by that because it's going to be safer. And actually, because it was the extension was R, it opened it already in the right. Okay, so once again, we have all the. Let's start by downloading the package, or I probably already have it. Otherwise, just say install and just look for Plottrix. Yeah, here it is. Okay. I don't do it because I think I already have it, but maybe not. I do. Okay, so just turn it on. And so again, in the code, we have, we don't have a file really, right? Our file is really just these two sets of information, the numbers and the cities. So here, after the parentheses part that lists all those numbers, oops, that's kind of cool. I can zoom in within R. It just has a little attribute that says number of columns too. So we're just going to do two columns. And by row, true, just use that. And then, so let's try to run that and see if we get any errors. Probably not, but okay. But nothing is visualized yet. So the row names are going to be, they're going to be displayed. Yeah, on both sides. So everything is in quotation marks separated by the comma. And we're going to run that as well. Okay, no errors. That's good. Let's see, do we get any errors? No. Okay, so exactly. These were the rows. Now, these are the column names. And in our case, we just want the year, right? So this could be anything here. So run that, and now within this particular package the code is called bump chart, supposedly because if you have many points you're gonna have lots of bumps, right, in this crazy graph, you know, spaghetti like graph. But in our case there are not gonna be any bumps, they're gonna be just slopes. Actually, sorry, the bump chart, I'm not sure if this will produce it, but this is also giving us the main title of the chart. Okay, so you can write whatever you want in there. So let's run that, and actually it does produce it. So this is pretty nice. I mean, it's a little crowded, but it already did produce what we wanted. That's always nice when that happens. So now Right now, one thing I don't think that's happening is that they're actually ranked by their, let's see, by their percentage. In any case, what we wanted to do is, no, actually, it is correct. Sorry, it is correct. So now we just need to add labels because we need to know what these numbers are, right? And so we're going to add the percentages and the tick marks. And the position for those, I don't know exactly, you know, there is no real grid here, but 1.1 and 1.9 is just going to give some position around there and around there for where to put this information, okay? And the colors of the line, in this case, rainbow, just five colors, so it's going to make just a bunch of colors. Let's see if we can just run. Just that might give me an error. No, it did it. Okay. And then this I can't remember what it means, but we'll just run it just to make sure we don't miss anything. And now we're going to put the labels for the specific data points. It's defining where what the minimum and the maximum is, and so these are the percentages. So in the code, I can't, let's see if we here, rather than the PDF, you can see that the let's see. I don't know, I don't see 300. Yeah, it's hard to see, but I said somehow 300, and the last one, I think it's this one, 630. So you just pick something that's beyond your actual data. And for whatever reason, it just requires to repeat all this information like this. Just make sure you don't change anything. So let's try to run it. And they're not pretty because they're in a box, but the main thing to remember is that now these are in the right spot, hopefully, when we export it. Let's run that last line, and that's it. So now it's just a matter of fixing it up in Illustrator. And in terms of what the labels are, what I'll take in Illustrator is I'll take the midpoint of this box and just I'll call that my tick mark, okay? And yeah, and in this case, we don't have like even tick marks because they're just not useful, right? Just having 7, 5, 4, because these are very detailed already. So we'll export that now. And let's see what we get. I want to get something that's tall, right? So save as PDF. Directory. Open one. So I always forget. I think this is the height, so I'm just gonna say maybe 20 inches by 10 inches. And I'll try portrait. Save. Bad luck. I did the opposite, so I don't want this. I want this part. So it's PDF. Maybe I'll just say about, say, this letter size. Just pretend that's the simplest. Yeah, there we go. Okay. That's it. So this is now a matter of just organizing it, you know, the best possible way, because obviously, you know, these labels are kind of in the wrong place. If we just quickly look, I'm not going to actually do it in Illustrator now because by now all the little tricks should have sort of learned them. But let's just look at the PDF, what I did. Yeah, so the overall picture, I mean, my graphs are tend to be a little bit, very subdued, so you can make them a little more, loud if you want. But I found that putting a gray box behind it does give it a certain presence that if it wasn't there, it's just not as, strong. And so what I did is I put the label of the title, of course, on top. I put these two labels could be bigger, right? 2011, 2012 should be definitely bigger. I highlighted only three teams just because, whatever, San Francisco, Washington, and Boston. And from that, you can see immediately that Washington did great, going from 2011 to 2012. But Boston did terrible. Now, of course, Boston won the World Series last year, right? If I'm correct, so they came back pretty nicely a year later, and then San Francisco did, pretty well. And here it's a little bit like problems that you might have with a timeline when you run out of room in order to put your names and labels. Also, you might have the problem that two teams may have exactly the same percentage. So, for example, LA Angels and San Francisco have the same percentage, but oh well. In this case, I made those labels bigger, the ones that I highlight, and I changed the colors, and I left everything else the same, very thin gray, dark gray for the lines and the dots, and light gray for the background, and the colored lines are actually thicker. and let's see. Oh. Actually, I was wrong. So the information that we did for the tick marks were, in fact, the tick marks, because if you notice, they are actually equally spaced every 20 points. Okay, so right now, if I wanted to say exactly what each team did, I would have to, pick that up from the data set, right, and just write next to it. But I figured it's not that important right here, because we can get that from the table. And of course, we don't need tick marks because the number becomes the tick, right? It becomes the little line, the little pointer. Okay, so that is it. Just to show you like a quick example of how useful this can be and how much more efficient and kind of lean and elegant it is, I'll try to show you something that I've been. So this one, well, of course, this is a lot of problems. The first of which is the fact that it's a 3D chart, and you don't want to do that, right? This is what Tafti calls chart junk. Absolutely, don't do 3D graphs because they're useless. Now, it's like scoring. It's showing how it's actually about. When you start preschool, now in New York, they're going to have a universal preschool start for everybody. And so this is showing the effect that if you start preschool at 4 years old, your scores are going to be much later on, much worse later on than if you started at 2 years old. Seems like a no-brainer, but anyway. So I just did a version of this graph for three groups. These are the sons of either executives, salespeople or farmers, and let me see if I can quickly show you the version of this thing showing parallel coordinates. So this is it. So this is basically this. The only difference being that here we have eliminated one of the groups, so there's no farmers, I believe. Yeah. We took out farmers mainly because also there was some missing data. So again, exactly the same graph, but look how much more efficient it is. So on the left column you have, if you start preschool at age 2, at age 10, these are your scores, okay? And these are like, based on a distribution, based on a standard deviation, but one being like a big jump. So here you can see that there's still a big difference between, white-collar kids, laborer kids, and intellectuals. Of course, the intellectuals have a higher score. But what it has here, they're pretty similar. Here's what happened actually if you start school at age four, if you start preschool at age four, that gap between, you know, the haves and have nots actually gets much wider. And here I just added a line for the average. And so not only you can compare, you know, point two different points in time, in this case it's more like two different categories, right? So very simple, you know, comparing A to B and showing how, for example, relative to the average, you know, everybody was a little bit above the average here, and here it's just like going really way down. So you can make something that's like that and totally incomprehensible, at least to the layperson, right? I mean, you know, maybe a statistician might have no problem, but to something like this. And that's the end of that.